All right. Welcome to the first session of the APL Computer Science and Engineering Seminar Series. First, I'd like to thank our sponsors, the business areas of civil space, national security space, and cyber operations for making this possible. The idea behind this series came from recognizing that APL is situated in a region that the high concentration of top universities doing important software and engineering research. We thought it would benefit the lab to bring in these researchers, to draw inspiration from them, and create opportunities for collaboration with them. So I could not be more pleased to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Michael Hicks. Dr. Hicks is an associate professor at the University of Maryland College Park in the Computer Science Department and Institute for Advanced Computer Studies, and is the director of the Maryland Cybersecurity Center. His research focuses on using programming languages and analyses to improve the security, reliability, and availability of software. His research has explored the design of new programming languages and analysis tools for automatically discovering or remediating software flaws and vulnerabilities. He has recently been exploring approaches to privacy-preserving computation and means to debug programs more effectively. Among his noteworthy accomplishments are his analysis and compilation tools to allow software to be automatically updated while it runs. And now, please join me in welcoming Dr. Michael Hicks.
Thank you very much. Is this microphone working? No? Maybe we need to increase the volume. Yeah, now it's working. Okay, good. Okay, great. Well, it's my pleasure to be here. Thanks very much for having me. Today I'm going to talk about a particular research project that I've been working on that Nate mentioned, being able to patch security or software on the fly while it's running. And then I'll spend the latter part of the talk introducing you to the Maryland Cybersecurity Center and telling you about some of the neat activities that we have going on and thinking that perhaps there will be opportunities for collaboration. Okay, so we use software a lot. We use it in ways that probably first come to mind when you mention that you use software a lot. So on your desktop or your laptop, maybe in your router to move your packets around, or in your smartphone, right? It's obvious there's software there. But there's also software in your coffee maker, in your TV, in the energy meter that's attached to your house, in your medical devices. And of course, as you here know very well, it's in weapon systems, aircraft, nuclear centrifuges. So that means that software failures are disruptive. And there's a litany of failures that you've probably heard about over the years that caused significant harm, from your car not breaking, to centrifuges being destroyed, to credit card numbers being stolen, to airports being down, to the entire Northeast being blacked out. So how do we fix these problems? Well, one thing we try to do is we try to patch the software, so somebody figures out what the bug is and they write a solution for it. And then they have to decide, the owners of the software have to decide how to deploy the solution or whether to deploy it. And so in 2010, the NASDAQ had a patch to a potentially critical security vulnerability and decided not to deploy it because they didn't want to take the system down. But then, in fact, the system was hacked and they lost a whole bunch of data. So they didn't sort of win that argument in that case. On the other hand, there's good reason for not wanting to take your system down, right? We've all had to deal with all of this. You know, that's kind of irritating, and it seems like it's a small risk that you're taking by not updating your software, but the security people tell us again and again that we probably ought to do it. So my research is focusing on programming languages as a mechanism to solving these software quality problems. So I look at ways to build software better the first time, so maybe we have to patch it less, ways to analyze software that we already wrote to look for potential problems in it, or maybe to retrofit it in a way that it's going to be more secure, and also to look at ways in which we can update software on the fly, which is the subject of this talk. Typically, the way the research that my group does works is that we will think of the idea, we'll formalize it in some way, do some mathematics to prove that the method is correct or that it satisfies some nice property, and then we'll implement and evaluate the idea and see how it works in practice. So today I'm going to talk about dynamic software updating, and as I said, I'll then talk about the Maryland Cybersecurity Center. Okay, so dynamic software updating is a solution to the problem we were just looking at because it gives you a way to update your program without shutting it down. And so by avoiding the interruptions of stop and restart, you can preserve critical program state. You can keep transactions running that you would otherwise halt. And so this is going to be useful for nonstop services like, say, the NASDAQ that's going to be running all the time, maybe even more nonstop services like software systems running critical state, you know, like power plants or internet servers or things like this. In particular, things with long-lived connections or with large in-memory state are probably very good candidates for dynamic updating, assuming that they have high uptime requirements. So the way that it works is that your software is running along. We'll call it running at version zero. And at some point, an update becomes available. So the vendor issues a patch. And now what you want to do is you want to upgrade the software without shutting it down. At this point, the software has accumulated some amount of important state. It's got a bunch of information. If it's a router, it has all the routing tables in memory that if you were to shut it down, it would have to regenerate these tables, for example, by running BGP or some routing protocol. So we'd like to not do that. So the way that dynamic software updating will solve that problem is that the version one code will be loaded into the running program. The state will be preserved and then transformed in some way so it corresponds to the requirements of the new code. And then the program will continue to run. So there are actually some forms of dynamic updating that are mainstream now. In language runtime systems like in Java or .NET, there are ways that you can modify elements of your program on the fly. There are some tools that allow you to do this in an ad hoc basis in applications. And the most notable success in this area is a company called K-Splice. They support dynamic updates for security-oriented patches to the Linux kernel, and they were bought by Oracle in 2011. Sadly, what was a really great service before Oracle bought it is now basically defunct. So I think that Oracle bought them basically to shut them down. Okay, so the way that people often look at implementing this idea is they think, okay, I have this piece of software and I'd like to upgrade it on the fly, but I really want to just keep writing my software the same way that I wrote it before. I don't want to take this existing C program or this existing Java program and wave my magic wand and get this dynamic updating feature. But maybe that's a good goal, but hard to achieve. At least in the 10 years I've been looking at this problem, that's what I've found. So for C programs in particular, in order to make things transparent, you tend to have to compile the program in a way that allows it to change, which will introduce levels of indirection or overhead, other forms of overhead that probably you didn't want to have or you wouldn't have been writing your program in C in the first place. So we tried to develop transparent approaches to dynamic updating for quite a while at Maryland, and we achieved some level of success, but the performance overhead and the pain of getting your program to correspond to the assumptions of the tool really wasn't worth it. And ultimately, it wasn't as transparent as you might have hoped that it would be. The tool would come in and try to change your software in a magic way, but it almost never got it right, and so then the programmer would have to understand enough to fix it. So our most recent approach has been to provide a framework in which we require the programmer to make some small changes to the program, but the easy stuff, the stuff that we can really reliably automate, the tool will take care of. So we think of dynamic updating then as a program feature like any other feature you would add to your program. If you want to add a new way of querying your database, you don't imagine you can wave your magic wand and provide it. Instead, you imagine you'll modify your program in some way to support this query interface. So in the same way, we can add dynamic updating as a feature that once added is easy to maintain so that as over time your program changes, few changes will be made to the dynamic updating part just like any other feature. Okay, and this approach is nice because the representation, the implementation of dynamic updating is inside of your program, and as such, you have complete control over how it works, and we found that it, in fact, works very well. So our design has three ideas. First is that we can update programs sort of all at once by loading in a new version of the program in its entirety and transitioning from the old to the new version and migrating the state. You'll see what I mean more about that in a minute. Another is that the programmer will indicate where during the program's execution the dynamic update should take place. Basically, there will be little polling points in the code that say, well, if there's an update ready, this is a fine time to apply it. And then finally, we have a tool called XFGen that helps the programmer orchestrate that transformation process that I showed pictorially before, that the representation of data structures might have changed from one version to another, and so this tool will help the programmer write those transformations in a way that's hopefully correct. So I'll give you the punchline before I give you the details. So we have used this approach, Kitsune, on 6 open source programs. We used it on Memcached, Redis, Icecast, Snort, for 3 to 6 months of releases, usually 4 releases, so we did 3 dynamic updates. All these programs have significant in-memory state. Memcached and Redis are both in-memory databases. This is kind of the way the world is going now because RAM is so cheap and so fast. Icecast is a streaming media server, and Snort, as you may know, is an intrusion detection system that does packet processing. So all these things have strong uptime requirements and high performance requirements. Tor is an anonymous routing system, and VSFTBD is a FTP server. And Kitsune supports single and multi-threaded programs. So we applied dynamic updates to all these programs, and we totaled 38 dynamic updates in all that we tried for all the programs. And performance measurement showed that basically it's in any overhead that we impose is in the noise. Update times are pretty fast, so the service is only paused very briefly while you perform the update. And even though I've told you, oh, the programmer is going to have to do some of the work, it's not that much work in terms of the lines of code that you have to change. For Tor, for example, I think Tor was, sorry, maybe Snort's a better example. Snort is 220,000 lines of code, and I think we changed 500 lines of it to support dynamic updating. Okay, so for the rest of this part of the talk, I'm going to give you more details about how this actually works, and then we'll dig into those performance numbers and experiments at the end so that you can see where those conclusions came from. Okay, so first of all, the way that Kitsune works is it uses a whole program update strategy. And the way that we do that is we compile a little C program, it's 100 lines long, a driver, that will be used to dynamically load in the entire first version of the program. And the way that we do that is we compile the program to a shared object file rather than to a standard executable. So this amounts to changing a few compile time flags when you build your program. Okay, so then the driver starts running the main program, and it starts accumulating this state as it's running along. And eventually, it will reach one of these polling points when a dynamic update is available. And so at that point, the polling point will jump back to the driver, and it will load in the next version of the program, also compiled to be a shared object file. It will then start running the new version of the program. And in so doing, it will make a few library calls that will help migrate the state over from the old version to the new version. Now, mind you, all of these are in the same address space, and so if the state hasn't changed in any interesting way, this migration is going to amount to copying a few pointers, and that's it, which is why most of those updates were really fast. Okay, so once that happens, the program will make its way back to sort of the equivalent point that it was at before when the dynamic update took place, sort of the equivalent polling point, at which point we know that it's now safe to free the old resources, so the old program is freed, and any other memory that might have been hanging around we don't need anymore, we will free up, and then the program will just continue as before. So this is a flow chart of the way that you would use Kitsune. I put this up here because most of the time when people give talks like this, they don't tell you about the nastiness in the background of, oh, well, you have to completely change the way you build your program, or you have to use some complicated tool that doesn't make any sense. Really, it's a very simple change to your build process. Instead of using GCC there, as you normally would, you add these extra flags, fpic and fvisibilityTrue, to compile them to position-independent code. You run it through our source-to-source translator, which is just going to add a few library calls automatically to your program, and then you basically just compile it as before. So it's really not very much of a change at all. Okay, so what does the programmer have to do to make this model work? A couple of things. First of all, the programmer is going to need to insert these update points that I mentioned, these polling points that will check when a dynamic update might be ready. The second is the programmer is going to have to write the code that's going to transform the state should the representation have changed from the old version to the new one. And then finally, the programmer is going to have to write a little bit of code so that when we restart the new version of the program after we've done the dynamic update, it doesn't begin the program as it normally would, opening up connections and initializing state, but it takes sort of a different path in order to migrate the state over safely and not clobber it with its normal beginning operations. And this XFGen tool that I mentioned before is going to help with the data migration process. So I'm going to show you this in a piece of code to try to give you a sense of the changes that you would end up having to make. So this is just a little server program that has a main function here. First thing that it does is it's going to allocate a mapping. We can imagine this server program is implementing a key value store. Clients are going to send requests like in Redis or Memcached. Here's a key, and then it will serve back a value, a cache value perhaps. So it's going to initialize this mapping, initialize the listen socket for accepting connections, and then it will enter this main loop of accepting connections from clients and then processing their commands. The client loop is there at the top, and it's going to process whatever requests they have until they disconnect. Okay, so here's how we would change this program to support, so that it can support Kitsune-style updates. The first thing we do, as I said, is we're going to pick the update points, and that's going to be pretty easy to figure out. Basically, the update points are going to be in any long-running loop that you have in your program where you're continuously accepting requests. The idea is that the requests are going to come in repeatedly, so you're going to repeatedly go around this loop, and you can think in some sense of the dynamic update being just another request that the program is being modified to support. And what we find is that in typical long-running programs, you're looking at 2 to maybe 5 of these polling points that you'll add. OK, so the next thing is you're going to add the data migration code. So this is along the restart path. So when the new version of the program starts, it's going to now have to go through the main code, but not initialize things as before. Instead, it's going to start to migrate the state. So the first thing is this call to do auto migrate. That's going to have the effect of just copying the pointers for those mappings, the global variables at the top. And in addition, we're going to have to perform this control migration code to avoid overwriting the mapping that we just migrated in the case of a dynamic update. So we have this call to is updating. If that call is false, then you're starting the program from scratch. If it's true, you're restarting it as part of a dynamic update. And so you don't want to reinitialize the listen socket or the mapping. You want to keep the one that you had before. And this little bit of code here is redirecting the control flow to the client loop if the update occurred in the client as opposed to in the server. OK, and I haven't shown you how we deal with multi-threaded programs. I didn't show anything about local variables, but we can handle those too. OK, so you might be looking at this code and saying, wow, there's more red than black there. I thought you said before that you didn't have to make very many changes to the program. Well, the observation is that the changes that you make to the program are basically localized in the code that I just showed you, that is in the main function and in sort of the parts that are shallow in the control flow graph. And most of the interesting functionality of your program has nothing to do with dynamic updating, and so you won't have to change it. OK, so the part where I showed you the do auto migrate call, what that's going to do is it's going to call into some routines to start copying the state, but also transforming the state if its representation changed. Maybe you added a couple of fields to a struct. Maybe you made an array longer. Who knows? However you might have changed your program, you need to support this change. So in order to facilitate that, we've developed a language that makes it easy to write these transformations. So here's an example to show how it works. Let's say that in our old program, we had this type def for data, and we had this mapping. And now in the new program, we've changed ints. It's no, data is no longer an integer, but now it's a string. OK, so now when we update the state, all of the integers that were in the mapping before, we're going to have to transform into strings that logically correspond to those. Our system is not going to be able to figure that out automatically. So the programmer is going to have to write that code to say how to do that transformation. But what they're not going to have to write is this code, which is the bit of code that goes through every possible mapping that currently exists in your program, finds it, performs the transformation to convert this integer to a string, and then carries on with the program. Instead, what's going to happen is the XFGen tool is going to ask the programmer to write this relevant transformation code, and then it will automatically generate the code that finds all of the instances of mapping in your program, basically by doing a garbage collection style traversal, and then will perform those updates for you. So what the programmer would write is shown here. They would basically say malloc space for the string, and then perform an SN printf to turn the integer into a string representation, or whatever makes sense for your program. OK, so then in using XFGen, the little build process changes. Basically, now XFGen is going to start, or the build process is going to store some extra files to keep track of what the type definitions were from version 1 to version 2. And XFGen is going to help you figure out which types changed so that you know what code you have to write. And it will also use those types files to generate this traversal. OK, so I'm just going to skip this. OK, so that's basically it. Maybe I'll swing back around toward the end if there are any questions to show that stuff I just skipped, which just explains a little bit about the XFGen language and how it works. But I want to jump right into the results. So I already talked about these programs that we're able to support. First of all, I want to show you some statistics about the way that we had to change these programs to support dynamic updating. So along the top there are some statistics about the lines of code in these programs and how many releases that we considered in performing dynamic updating. So for the three at the bottom and for Redis, these were all, as I said before, 3 to 6 months worth of actual releases, right? So these are open source programs. Releases came out, we took the release, we modified it to work with our framework and so on. For Tor and VSFTPD, those release cycles correspond to 4 years for VSFTPD and 2 years for Tor. Along the bottom here is a summary of the way that those programs had to change in order to support dynamic updates. This column here that's in yellow with the sigma there is a sum of all of the lines of code we changed across all releases of these programs. The part to the left of the plus are the lines of code we changed in the first version to basically add dynamic updating as a program feature. And the stuff to the right of the plus are lines that we had to change to support dynamic updating in some subsequent release. So what you can see is that the large majority of these changes happened in the first version, and some small maintenance in some cases had to occur in subsequent versions. Although I would point out that VSFTPD, those 30 lines to the right of the plus, that was over 4 years of total in 13 releases, right? So that's not very many changes over that time. And in all of the other cases, the changes were relatively small. That sum is summing up this information that's to the left, where it says control data E underscore and other. These were changes that we made for UPD is the number of update points. Control is lines of code we changed to support control migration. Data is lines of code we changed to support data migration. E underscore are annotations we added to types to facilitate the garbage collection style traversal. And then other is other stuff we couldn't exactly characterize. Okay, the stuff on the right-hand side of the line there, where the other XF LOC is, are XFgen lines of code that we wrote to support the way data structures changed over time with these particular programs. And so again, the number of lines of specification of XFgen specs was relatively small. The stuff to the left of that is the total number of specifications. V to V is variables that change, maybe their type changed, or maybe new global variables were added. T to T is type definitions that changed. Maybe a new field was added to a struct or a type def changed or something like that. Okay, so remember back in our introduction, we were talking about why might you perform these dynamic updates, and one reason might be critical security patches. So looking at the particular programs that we had dynamically updated, notably VSFTPD and Tor, both of these are about secure services. VSFTPD stands for very secure FTP daemon, and Tor is an anonymous router that uses cryptography and so on, and so these things are meant to be secure. So there are many updates that took place during the release cycle that we looked at that specifically address security. Here's some for Tor, heap overflow bug that could allow remote execution, something that prevents a denial of service attack, hiding secret keys so that you can't see them in memory. So if we were not to perform dynamic updating and we were just let these servers run continuously, we would be exposed having once these releases came out, and the Kitsune-enabled versions allow the updates to happen essentially immediately, and this exposure goes away. Okay, so hopefully I've shown you that it's not too much code that you have to write. Maybe that's a little misleading because perhaps you can write two lines of code that are really hard to figure out, right? Really hard bug to fix might be a one-line change that takes you 4 days to find. So it's not a one-to-one correspondence with effort, but still it would be more disturbing if it was huge amounts of code that changed. Another thing you might be worried about is the performance overhead. So what this table shows is the amount of overhead that you get when that's imposed on normal execution just by having Kitsune implemented in your program. So the automatic approaches, the transparent approaches that I mentioned before that compile the program differently to add levels of indirection or add padding to structs or things like that are going to make it so that regular non-updating execution is slowed down. And we can see that with these columns on the right where it says ginseng and upstair. These are two competing dynamic updating approaches that do compile the program differently. And for these rows of the table on the bottom, you can see that they add significant overhead in some cases to normal execution. The part that's in yellow is the overhead for Kitsune. That's the percentage overhead for running with and without, and essentially it's in the noise. It gets 2% faster in some cases and 2% slower in other cases. When things got 2% faster, That used to bother me. But I've come up to I've come to appreciate that modern architectures are completely unpredictable, and that you can change the link order of your program. If you had 10 files and you just randomly rearrange the order in which you link them together, you can get up to an 8% performance improvement. This was a paper in AskPlus a couple of years ago. So 2% really is in the noise on a modern architecture where they're doing all kinds of out-of-order scheduling and caching and stuff in the background. Okay, so basically not very much overhead. Update times are another important thing. If it took an hour to dynamically update your program, yeah, you still have the state, but your service is unavailable, so that would be no good. So you want updates to be very fast. We get to preserve the state, and we want to get to the new version as quickly as possible. So what this chart shows is that, by and large, the amount of time that it takes to do a dynamic update is small, typically less than 40 milliseconds. There's one notable exception here. So Icecast takes almost a second. Any guesses as to why it takes that long? OK, so just below that, you see Icecast-NSP, and that's much faster, 187 milliseconds. The reason that the first one is so slow, Icecast has six threads in it that are performing interoperating features of doing streaming media. And they all have 1 second sleeps in them. So basically, at any point when you're running this program, when one thread has reached an update point and it's waiting for the other threads to reach their update point so it can perform the update, those threads might be stuck on one of these 1 second sleeps. And on average, over many updates, it turns out that update times take, surprise, surprise, about 1 second. So if we get rid of these sleeps, which are good for streaming media and for stability, the update time gets even smaller. A newer version of Icecast, we have a new version of our library that sort of allows you to break out of sleeps if you want to. And then we can actually do even better. Here's some results for Snort. This is sort of work in progress in terms of the performance analysis. We're in the process of writing a follow-up paper to our original paper. And this is just to show you we can support sort of the same rate of traffic for Snort as we could before. We can send through 30 packets per second of attack traffic and then perform a dynamic update. And basically, the update takes on the order of a few hundred milliseconds. OK, so hopefully you get the idea that you can take your C program, you can retrofit it without too much effort, you can run it at the same performance as it was before, and you can dynamically update it without too much of a delay to stay up to date. And maybe all these things are good things. But you might want more than that. You might be skeptical because you might be worried that if I change my program on the fly, what if I do something wrong and the program crashes or it fires the missiles when it wasn't supposed to fire the missiles? That would be bad. In fact, that would be worse than shutting it down and restarting. So how can you be convinced that your dynamic update is doing the right thing while you're when you performed it? So one thing you can do is you can use formal methods and you can use testing techniques, adapting a long tried and true research literature to this particular problem of dynamic updating. And we have been doing that by looking at how to write specifications for behavior that a client might observe when starting at the old version, updating, and sort of continuing on in the new version. Most of the time, that behavior is going to be the same. When you're fixing a security vulnerability, the only behavior you're changing is behavior you didn't want before anyway. So there's no need to worry about preserving or accepting behavior in a different way. On the other hand, one interesting case that came up for us is one of these updates to VSFTBD started allowing an arbitrary number of connections from any host, but a new version rate limited those connections so that you were only allowed to have, say, 5 from a particular IP address. So one interesting conundrum is if I dynamically update my program and I have 6 connections to some host, now I'm running the new version, but it's not in compliant with the whole reason the new version was around. I have 6 connections live when I was supposed to limit it at 5. Okay, well, what should you do? Well, one thing you could do is you could decide to just leave the 6 connections open, but once you fall below 5, you never let it go above 5. Or you could randomly kill one of the 6 connections in order to rate limit immediately. Or you could take some other policy. And the point is, in this case, it's really up to the programmer to decide what behavior makes the most sense, and then to be able to test it, specify it, prove something about it. And that's stuff that we've been working on and are going to continue to work on. Another thing that would be useful is to not have to write some of this transformation code entirely on your own. Even though these XFGen rules are relatively simple, they're not completely trivial. And so maybe tool support would help you. And we had a paper that came out last year that was able to look at execution traces of old and new versions of programs, and by comparing similar behaviors but with the different versions of the code, we were able to automatically derive transformations using software synthesis technologies. And for example, we could automatically transform out memory leaks so that if you've been running your program for a while and you'd leaked all this memory, you'd like your dynamic update to not just fix the code but actually run through memory and free all that stuff that you didn't free before. And this automated approach was able to figure out how to do that. We're in the process now of adapting the Kitsune methodology to work for Java programs. So we have a prototype called Ruba. Ruba is the Indonesian word for fox, and on Ruba, Ruba is the Indonesian word for fox, and and on the island of Java, they speak Indonesian. That's where it came from. Okay, and then the last thing is, these updates were relatively fast for the cases that I showed you, but they could be slow. So if you had a memcached server with, say, 64 gigabytes of memory, all completely filled by these tables, and you changed your representation, you'd have to run through the entire 64 gigabytes of memory to potentially change this stuff, and your program's going to be paused that entire time. Now, the alternative of using Kitsune for this is to save all that stuff to disk and then restart and load it back up again. That's what Redis does. But in that particular case, it would take you like 15 minutes to restart, to just dump 64 gigs to disk and then read it back in again. So we'd still be better even doing it all just in memory, but we'd like to be able to have the pause time be smaller. So we're looking at sort of lazy ways to transform the state so you can do it on the fly. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about the Maryland Cybersecurity Center, but maybe I'll invite questions now, since I'm going to completely switch topics. Yeah?
So when dealing with upgrading your software,
When dealing with upgrading your software, are there version control and limitations so that you know that when you're doing an update that you're going from version 0 to 1 to 2 as opposed to perhaps somebody hadn't run one of the previous updates and going from 0 to 2?
That's a great question. So the question, so basically if you were, there's no conceptual limitation, but the sort of bigger the change between the two versions of the software that you're updating, the harder it is to write the change. You can imagine if you did a dynamic update where you changed, 10 data structures, and you did it one data structure at a time, it might be conceptually easier to make those updates happen piecemeal rather than in one big jump. So we've basically just been doing release level updates, but at the same time, if we were to do updates at the level of, say, a subversion, a code repo commit, even sub releases, actually that would be even easier to do. And this methodology, I think, would afford you, this is what Facebook and Etsy and all these companies do these days, is they actually push out new releases, code releases daily. Our methodology is even better suited for that. So the point is, it would be harder if we waited longer, but there's not really that great of a reason to wait longer, so it's not a big deal. Yep?
How do you see this as a tool for hackers to use to make it easier to introduce vulnerabilities or to take advantage of systems?
Okay, so the question was, can bad guys use Kitsune to load malicious code or something like that into your system or to perform other illicit acts? So I would say that there is an added risk. So you've now added this capability to your program so that it can be upgraded on the fly. And how will that happen? Well, it's going to happen through some signaling mechanism. The way that we implement it now is you need to, if you're running this program on the machine, you have to have access to the machine and you have to be able to signal this process to say that an update is available. You could very easily add crypto and sort of authentication, authorization sort of logic to make sure that the update really is authorized. There is some risk that there's a software vulnerability that Kitsune could be co-opted into doing something bad. I don't have a very good answer for that. That's true. You could also imagine Kitsune being really useful for people running like command and control servers for botnets or something like that, because now they have a way of more easily upgrading their software without having to shut it down and restart it. So all of these things are true. I guess the way that I think of it is that I think it's a risk that can be managed, and it's probably in your favor to do this rather than not do it. Somebody told me once when automobiles came out and they were starting to become popular that police hated automobiles because bank robbers could get away from the scene of the crime faster. right? But at the same time, it's a technology that's generic and that everyone can benefit from it, both bad guys and good guys. And hopefully, on balance, the good guys are going to be better off. Yeah?
So how hard is it to debug? It seems to me there's...
So how hard is it to debug? It seems to me there's a lot of potential here to, you know, you write your XFgen, and then it turns out you didn't quite transform the data right, and everything crashes instead of shutting it down nicely and restarting.
Okay, that's a great question. So the way that we do it is we use standard tools. This is another benefit of the methodology that we have. So GDB already allows you to deal with dynamically loaded libraries. In this case, we have two independent dynamically loaded libraries. So they have the same symbol names, but GDB is able to help you tell the difference between these two. So we can actually start a process, run it along, dynamically update it in GDB in order to debug why something didn't work while we're testing it. In terms of debugging transformation rules and things like that, one methodology we have developed in the past is to perform what's called systematic testing. So basically you can imagine that, let's say I have a test that applies to both the old version and the new version. Like maybe my test is stick a bunch of stuff in my key value store, do a bunch of other operations, and then pull something out and make sure it's the same thing that I put in. So now what I can do is I can take the same test, but non-deterministically in the middle of the test, perform the dynamic update and see if the test still passes. And in that way, for backward compatible tests, you can do this kind of fuzz testing idea, and you can even do it systematically. We've built analysis tools to do that, to help you be sure that no matter when the update happens, everything is still going to work as planned. But there's no question that it is a greater burden. It is something that you have to, you know, it's now a feature of your program. You do need to test it. But existing testing techniques and frameworks and even formal methods still apply.
If version 2 of the program depends on a newer shared library like glibc, does this automatically handle that, or do you need to integrate Kitsune into your glibc?
Okay, so what happens if libraries change and the new version depends on the libraries? That's a good question. So I think, so that would create a separate problem that on your deployed machine, it's got installed this particular version of the shared library, and now you have this new version that wants a newer version of the shared library. So you'd have to have some mechanism of getting the new version of the shared library there and not having that somehow conflict with the other software that you might have running on the same machine. I imagine that you can do that. And then when you load the new version, I mean, I believe that now shared libraries can be tagged with versions, and so when you load a program, you'll get the correct version of the library if it depends on that version. So I think as long as you push the library out to the machine and you do the update, I think it should work. Yeah?
So you mentioned that data transformation on something like memcache with a lot of memory would be expensive. Did you characterize how often programmer the abstractions change and requiring these transformations across different versions, and also how quick Kitsune is per the amount of actual data that's changing?
I have some hidden slides here. Let me find them. Whoops, there it was. Okay, this slide is a little bit stale. What it shows is, this is a version of Redis, and this is the number of key value pairs in Redis. So what's happening in this particular upgrade is it's actually having to run through the entire heap to do something with this sort of hash chained data structure that Redis uses to implement its database. And so as you might expect, there's this linear increase as the number of key value pairs goes up. What this is actually doing is it turns out that Redis uses the addresses of some global variables effectively as tags to say that this is this kind of data or this kind of data. And so what happens is because those tags in the new version now have different addresses, they're different global variables in the new version, we have to run through the entire heap and redirect all pointers that used to go there to now point to these new tags instead. So that's where this time is going. And so you can see that, you know, we're going up here on the order of hundreds of milliseconds. I think in the case of, we did some experiments where you have a 16 gigabyte heap, this would take like 800 milliseconds or something like that. Now, as it turns out, this is a stupid thing to do. You ought to just use an enumerated type rather than these global variables. So we change Redis to do that, and then, of course, the update time is flat because you don't have to run through the heap anymore. So in more recent work, what we've done is we've figured out a way to generalize this transformation so you can do it in parallel. And now the version of Redis that has 16 gigabytes we can do in 250 milliseconds because we have four threads that are all converting all of this stuff in parallel. And we use non-blocking synchronization and stuff to make sure that that's safe. Your other question was, how often does this sort of change take place? I mean, basically, in the 38 updates that we looked at, these are the changes to types where a type definition changed in some way. But in all of these cases, the fundamental data structure, the Memcache data structure or the Redis data structure, did not change over that period. So I'm not sure. Maybe that changed before and after. I couldn't tell you exactly. But these are all at least 3 months, in some cases 6 months or even 4 years. And we never had that kind of big change. Actually, I can tell you another story that's funny about that. So Facebook, as it turns out, has a dynamic updating strategy for Memcache. If you didn't have, they have a paper coming out at NSDI. Maybe it already came out. Well, no, it's coming out. On how they use a distributed form of Memcache. It turns out if they didn't use that, I mean, Facebook would completely fall over. They really, really depend on having Memcache to make back-end database accesses fast. So what they do to support dynamic upgrades is they hacked it so that all of the memory that supports the data is stored in a shared object file on disk, right? It's a dev, whatever, a RAM disk. And then when their hacked version starts up, it reconnects to the file that was holding all the data from the old version. So this is all fine as long as the data structure representation doesn't change, the memory manager doesn't change, those features of the program stay the same, and it's just other features of Memcached that have changed. But they find this to be invaluable. With Kitsune, you'd have a little bit more principled way of doing this. Yep?
So updates only can move forward. You can't undo an update, can you?
You would have to just treat going backwards as if it were a forward update. So basically, our tool would, you would take version 1, and then you would say, I want to update to version 0, and the tool would notice which types have changed. Yet that is, oh, I added 3 fields to this struct, now those 3 fields are gone. And then you would develop a backwards transformation and so on.
That's a new update, really.
It's a new update, that's right. There's no magic rollback, only because once you've done the update, the world has moved on. All those data structures have changed. You've started to take advantage of the new features. And so there's no automatic way to figure out how do I sort of take into account that 27 new objects have been uploaded, but now I want to revert to the old representation.
So this is something you're trying to introduce into a software engineer's toolbox or a software developer's toolbox, right?
The yes.
Code differently.
That's right. Yes.
Could you carry this to a more automated, but maybe a more targeted problem where if you have this kind of embedded in the program that's running, the program gets attacked, you detect that attack, you now want to automatically correct whatever bad behavior occurred, but not lose your state. So could you roll this into that? I mean, I think you'd have to automatically generate the new code to do that.
Let's see, so the question is, could we defend against attacks using this technology?
And use it for recovery.
I would say, I think automation is challenging because you would have to know in what way the attack affected your program in order to fix it. You can certainly use it to recover from attacks if you know what the attack did and you don't want to lose your state. So the example I gave with a memory leak before, right, I have this mistake that has this effect, and I'd like to correct the effect after the fact. And you can certainly use Kitsune to do that. But I'm still anticipating in that case that the programmer is going to need to get involved to think about it. It's possible you could, if you had, you used our synthesis strategy of looking, you had a way of sort of in your lab looking at the effect of the attack in the normal program, you could synthesize a correction to the program. One thing I have thought about is, could you defend against attacks? Could you mitigate vulnerabilities by updating yourself on a regular basis with semantics-preserving transformations, right? So think about address-based layout randomization as a really specialized form of change where you could do that on the fly, where I could just have a tool take my program and change it so that all the addresses of all the functions just got moved around and the stack layouts got changed, and then I use Kitsune to automatically update itself and change all of the contents. And then do it again, and do it again, and do it again, as long as your updates are relatively fast. Okay, great questions. All right, let's finish up with talking about this other stuff. Okay, so as Nate said, at the University of Maryland College Park, we have this new cybersecurity center. It's called the Maryland Cybersecurity Center. And you know, there's lots of stuff about cybersecurity going on in the state of Maryland. And as it turns out, we had a lot of really good faculty who were operating sort of independently at College Park. And a few years ago, people got the bright idea of, hey, let's bring these people together, not just in computer science or in electrical engineering, but all across campus, to try to put our heads together to cracking this cybersecurity problem. So it's the goal of the center is to help facilitate new research, but also new education initiatives, and to, at least to some degree, expand public awareness of the problem and ideas for solving it. So I've been the director of the center for a year and a half now. And we have a deputy director of the center who used to be involved on the Hill. He was Barbara Mikulski's on her national security advisory team. And he's great. His Rolodex has got lots of really interesting people in it. And then Michel Couquier, who's in engineering, is our education director. So we have lots of people doing research on various aspects of security. I'm going to show you pictorially some of the things that we're looking at. We also have a bunch of non-technical people who look at security from a different angle, which I think is really great. So Larry Gordon and Marty Loeb, for example, look at the economics of security. How much should you invest? How much does a security breach affect your stock price? How is the new SEC guidance that requires you to report data breaches affecting companies' behavior, sort of studying the security as a broader social problem? Supply chain security is another thing of interest the business school folks are looking at. Policy and psychology. So we have a lot of people looking at things in different areas. Okay, so I'm going to focus on some of the technical strengths that we have, and I'm just going to use a couple of pictures to organize my thoughts. So suppose we have Alice and Bob, and Alice and Bob communicate, and they compute. So Alice sends Bob a message, he does something, sends a message back to Alice, she does something, and so on. Okay, so what can go wrong in this scenario? Well, one thing is that Charlie could watch the message and steal information. And so, of course, this is the domain of cryptography. And we have a bunch of people that do cryptography from establishing secure channels to using to looking at key generation and resilience strategies to even doing things that aren't involving cryptography, like physical channel characteristics based on information theory to protect the data. So we have great people already. And we just, in fact, hired Donna a couple of weeks ago. She accepted our offer. She got her PhD at Columbia, and she also does really interesting stuff in crypto. Okay, so another thing that you might like to secure is the computation itself. So for example, suppose that Alice and Bob want to compute some function of private information they have, but they don't want the other to see that private information. Maybe they want to figure out who's richer, but they don't want to reveal how much money they have. So what they could do is they could send that information to Peter. He could perform the computation, and he could send them back the result, but now they have to trust Peter. So secure multi-party computation is a technique that was proposed in the 80s that allows Alice and Bob to communicate directly and yet have the same property that they only learn the outcome of the computation and they never see the inputs. Of course, they might be able to infer something about the inputs because they know what the function is, but they won't ever see the entire inputs directly. So this is an increasingly exciting area. We have a big grant, myself, John Katz, and Elaine have grants in this area to look at scaling up secure multi-party computation to be used in practical settings. So here's a fun practical setting. Imagine that you meet somebody for the first time and you have some really weird interests, but if you met somebody else who had those same interests, it would be so cool. You know, you could do all of those, I don't know, I'm not even going to say what a weird interest is because I'll offend somebody. You could go off and do them together, right? So what you could do is you could have this technology on your phone and you could say, let's do a secure set intersection where we only learn the interests that we have in common and not the interests that we don't. And so then you go out, you do the secure set intersection, and you look, oh, it looks like we both like kayaking. And so then you can start talking about that and not about, you know, whatever your weird interest is. But maybe you find that you have a weird interest in common and then you live happily ever after. Right, so very practical. That's why we should spend lots of government money to research it. Okay, so, and Elaine is great. She just started from Berkeley. She began in the fall, and we're really happy to have her. Hardware and software assurance. This is something that I have spent a lot of time working on. You know, your server has a bug. The client figures out how to exploit the bug, and your server starts doing bad things. So what can we do by that? Well, we can try to build the software to be correct by construction. We can try to understand the sources of bugs by using binary code analysis or fuzz testing. We can try to prevent attacks by using hardware fingerprinting, for example. And we've looked at things for web apps, for systems code, for mobile phones, and lots of different people at the center are working on this problem. Mobile code, I just sort of mentioned it. That's a big deal. I want to be able to send code to Bob, and Bob might want to send code to me. How might that happen? Well, you know, you're getting JavaScript code whenever you connect to a website, so the website's sending code to you. At the same time, you might be uploading plugins to a web service. Whenever you, you have a social networking site that allows you to author, say, HTML or something like that, you might be able to upload code to it, and then that could affect the site, or it could affect other users of the site. So we want to figure out ways in which we can protect against malice in this situation where we're moving code around. So one project we're spending a lot of time on now is thinking about cloud computing security. How can I take my programs and push them out to the cloud and run them in a way that the cloud provider doesn't have access to my private information? So the first thing you might think is, oh, well, I'll encrypt all of the data. But the cloud provider can see that data in the clear once you've decrypted it and it's stored in RAM. So you might think, oh, I'll use homomorphic encryption or some crazy idea like that. That's never going to be practical, sorry. So maybe quantum computing one day will be. I don't know. I'm sorry, I'm just being provocative. Maybe it will be. But there are a variety of approaches you could take involving certain forms of secure hardware, involving crypto, and we're sort of looking at a bunch of those different ideas in this setting. Okay, and then securing distributed systems is my catch-all. There are lots of ways in which systems communicate and need to be secure, from peer-to-peer systems in which each member of the computation is performing something and you need to, what happens if they do the wrong thing? What if they're a free rider? How do you incentivize them to participate? How do I make sure that I'm operating with people in the right way? We have lots of stuff going on in this area. Okay, so we have a really cool space now. If anybody would like to come and visit and check out what's going on, this is what you would see. We have a nice little reception area. We have a whole bunch of faculty offices around the perimeter. Scientists and students will be sitting in here. We have some conference rooms, kitchen, lounge, quiet space. If any of you have ever been into the A.V. Williams building on campus, this is hands down the best space in the entire building. It used to be the dean's space. See, that's why. The dean found better space on some other building and left, and then we grabbed his space. So in addition to the research, we, as I mentioned, we try to do public awareness and outreach. So we have a seminar series that I'll talk about in a minute that Google co-sponsors, where we get a bunch of great speakers to come and give talks. You're all welcome to come to that. If you want, send me an email and I'll put you on our list. We have a symposium that's happening next week. Maybe some of you are going to attend that. It's a two-day event. I'll talk a little bit about that. And then we also have a corporate partners program where we team with a lot of interesting companies. So this is a list of the Google Cybersecurity Seminar Speaker Series. We have people from academia, from research. So the people I just highlighted are ones from industry. It was really appropriate that Kevin Mandia came and gave a talk, and then like 3 months later, this huge Mandiant report came out and said, you know, China is doing all these things that we already knew they were doing. People from government, and also people from academia. So we've had a bunch of really great speakers, and you know, we get maybe 50 to 150 people depending on the talk. The funny thing is the most attended talk was Doug Maughan. Okay, so it wasn't really a research talk. Doug Maughan is, you'll know why this was the most well-attended talk. It's because he's a program manager at Homeland Security with a $50 million budget. So of course, all of the people from the Beltway Bandits came out of the woodwork to come to his talk. The symposium we're going to have next week, I'm really excited about the program. We have four keynote speakers. Fred Schneider from Cornell is going to speak about a doctrine for cybersecurity, sort of looking at technical and policy stuff. Steve Belevin is a professor at Columbia, but he's now the chief technologist at the FTC, so I think he'll have a really interesting perspective. He's, you know, one of the original progenitors of firewalls and sort of system security ideas. He's an old hat in the security area. Kathleen Fisher is a DARPA program manager. She works on formal verification and highly assured software systems. And Randy Sabat is a lawyer at Zwillgen, and he's been looking at this sort of controversial topic of active defense, where, you know, instead of defending against the bad guys, we attack them back. And what are the legal and technical ramifications of that approach? It's our symposium, so we get to decide who speaks, and we're going to have 8 internal speakers across the spectrum of people I just talked about speak upon various topics. And we have tutorials as well. We're going to have a tutorial on Boolean satisfiability, on using LLVM to write program analyses, on symbolic execution to find software vulnerabilities, and on sort of the underpinnings of secure computation. Okay, so I'm going to finish up in talking mostly about the education part of MC2. So we just kicked off, we will kick off in the fall, an honors program for undergraduates in cybersecurity. It's meant to be an interdisciplinary program where students will come in and they will see things from the policy side, from economics, in addition to the computer science and engineering side, to get a broader picture that will augment the major that they already are signed up for. So Northrop Grumman is a partner in that, and they gave us a very generous gift to get running. We've been developing some new courses. My favorite course is the Secure Maryland course. So this course came about because somebody hacked our website and then posted it on his blog. So it showed that he could inject HTML into the MC2 website. So this was embarrassing. It turned out it wasn't the MC2 website. It was worse than that. It was the University of Maryland's jobs application site that just happened to be in our frame. So I thought this was just awful that this would happen. And the way I solved the problem is I taught a class where I allow students to attack our network so they find these problems first, and then we fix them. So we taught the class for the first time in the spring. We had 7 students. They found literally hundreds of vulnerabilities. They hacked into the scoreboard. Turns out the scoreboard runs Windows. I mean, who would have thought? And it had a remote desktop vulnerability in it. Printers that are a problem. People just attach printers to the network. They have Telnet open. They have no root password. Anyway, so that's very interesting. And we're running that course again this spring. There's been some interest, actually, from state agencies now that we've been talking to of, once, you know, if this ever happens and we shore up the University of Maryland's networks, you know, would you please come and pen test our network so that we can be a little bit better? Okay, and so we have some professional courses and courses in other disciplines, too. And that's it. So I'm happy to take any questions about the center if you have any of those. And I would encourage you to come next week. It's Tuesday and Wednesday if you are able to. I know it's a difficult thing for some agencies that receive government funding because of the whole sequester thing. But anyway, it's going to be a good time if you can make it.